Good morning, everyone. Happy Father's Day to you. And thanks very much for being with us today. Today we have a special day planned in worship. Part of the tradition of this church is that in June, at the close of a program year, we always take a day to celebrate the music ministry. And we're really excited to have all of our choirs performing today and celebrating with us in worship. I'm really grateful for that. And so we look forward to that. We're also continuing our series on purpose with a message today about play. So we'll get to that in just a little while. So if you're here in person today, we hope you'll take a minute and share your contact information when the ushers come around with the red attendance pads. Let us know that you've been here. If you're online with us today, we want to say a special word of welcome to you as well. And you can go to medfordumc.org/Sunday. You can record your attendance there, but also find out some things about the church. There's some links that you might want to explore there. And if you'd like to take a look and you're here in the space, you can scan the QR code on the back of the pew in front of you and you'll be taken right to that page as well. So a couple of announcements as we're getting started. First, I want to say thanks to everyone who helped with the diaper drive that we've been in the middle of since Mother's Day. We know that those who are served by the Maker's Place in Trenton will really appreciate your donations and your generosity, so we thank you for that. So the second thing that I want to share with you is just that today is the last day to register for Vacation Bible School. VBS is coming the week of July 14th, and that's going to be happening in the evenings, starting on Sunday evening from 6 to 8. And registration is due today. Again, we are welcoming campers from age 4 years up to fifth grade. And so we look forward to being with you and your kids and your neighbor's kids and your grandkids. And we would love to celebrate with all of them during the week of July 14th. So I think those are all the announcements. And I'll turn to Barbara to lead us in the call to worship. Or no, we have a call to, we have a run call to worship this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I invite you to stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to your name, O Most High. To tell of your love early in the morning and of your faithfulness in the nighttime. O come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us rejoice in the rock of our salvation.
Amen.
be seated. Please join me in the opening prayer. Holy One, we thank you for leading us in every moment. We forget quickly that following you doesn't always mean we are do something active. It may mean taking to ponder, reflect, and wait. It may mean enjoying your presence with us in moments where we feel joy, in activities that feel light and playful. Help us to focus on being with you in this moment and trusting in your leadership. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you,
and also
with you. Amen. At this time, please rise as you're able and greet one another as you feel comfortable.
Good morning.
Today's reading comes from the Wisdom Book of Proverbs, the 8th chapter, beginning with verse 22. The Lord created me at the beginning of his way, before his deeds long in the past. I was formed in ancient times, at the beginning, before the earth was. When there were no watery depths, I was brought forth, when there were no springs flowing with water. Before the mountains were settled, before the hills, I was brought forth. Before God made the earth and the fields, or the first of the dry land. I was there when he established the heavens, when he marked out the horizon on the deep sea, when he thickened the clouds above, when he secured the fountains of the deep, when he set a limit for the seas, so the water could not go beyond his command, when he marked out the earth's foundations. I was beside him as a master of crafts. I was having fun, smiling before him all the time, frolicking in his inhabited earth and delighting in the human race. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Will you pray with me? God, we thank you for the gift of this day. We thank you for the gift of the scripture, and we pray that as we think together about what these words mean for us and what it is that we experience here in worship week by week through music, as we think more deeply about our own lives, that you might be at work in our hearts and our minds and our hearing and in our understanding. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You'd be surprised at the number of piano donations a pastor has to refuse through the years. I mean, it's been a lot. And, you know, I don't generally like to turn down when people offer the church something. But the church can only use so many pianos. And no, I don't know anybody who might want one. I think in the past 10 years, it's maybe been at least half a dozen, maybe more. So if you were thinking about sending me an email later, asking me if I could use a piano, please don't. Now, there was a time when having a piano at home really signified something about your family. Not only that you had kind of the means to be able to purchase a piano, but the value that you put on making music as a mark of, you know, family togetherness, also is a sign that we're a cultured family. We will make music in this house. And people would play and they would sing for family gatherings. They would sing at Christmas time or at other holidays. Now, and I apologize for those of you who are listening at home in your living rooms, now we ask Siri or Alexa to do it. And now everybody's Siri and Alexa is going off. It's just a lot easier that way. We have decided we leave music to the professionals because that's what's appropriate. Today it seems like amateur musicians have basically two outlets, church and a karaoke bar. Those are your two outlets. Notice how one of those involves a place where we have a little help in setting our inhibitions to be able to stand up and sing something aside. But if you want to sing or if you want to play in church, you've just kind of got to white knuckle it if you're nervous. And so for that reason alone, having been there, I want to give thanks for those who are willing to put themselves out there and stand and sing and play every single week. I am incredibly grateful to all of you. So can we say thank you? And for our professional musicians, for our music staff here, Bruce and Carol and Barb, just thank you so much for everything that you bring, the hours that you put in, not only the hours that you all see here, but the hours, and not even that, just the hours that the choirs see, but also the time that's spent practicing and perfecting and thinking and selecting music and reviewing new things and learning new techniques. It takes a lot to be able to enjoy what we enjoy week by week. And so I just want to say thank you to our music staff who offer so much. So can we thank them once more? We are grateful for your dedication. I feel like we have so few outlets for so many of the things that interest us because over time we've decided as a society that if we can't do something at the highest level, if we can't do something at a near professional level, then it's really not worth doing. We've lost sight of the joy of doing something for its own sake, just because it makes us happy. Just because it makes us feel good in order to do it, to be able to offer a gift that we have. And so what happens? We're at a place where people call the church to get rid of their piano rather than playing it. Now contrast this with when we're kids. Growing up, you probably had no problem filling an entire room with art. That your parent at some point has to figure out, what do I do with all these pictures that my kid painted for me, right? You had no problem doing that. Even if we're not the best at it, we just keep doing it over and over because we enjoy it because it gives us joy. But as we become adults, most of us outgrow our hobbies, it seems. If it doesn't earn us money, if it doesn't produce a result of some kind, we don't have time for it. And that's sad. What we end up with is a life that is diminished because we haven't invested in things that have given us joy. We haven't spent time doing things that help us to just be blessed with the creative power that God has given us. When we insist that everything in our lives must have a purpose, must have a reason for doing it, we may actually be missing out on one of the most important lessons that God has to teach us about purpose. So this passage of Scripture from Proverbs chapter 8 has some unique features. Now, it has some things in common, too, with other passages that we might read. It has something in common with John 1, and the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, one that we read frequently at Christmas time. It has something in common with Genesis 1, in the beginning. It has something in common, too, with the end of Job, where God answers Job from the whirlwind and says, "Where were you when I was busy creating all these things?" If you read from the beginning of Proverbs chapter 8, what you learn is that the person who's doing the speaking here is God's wisdom, divine wisdom personified as a woman. This is kind of a complicated example or complicated concept. Even biblical scholars don't quite understand what's being meant. And really, honestly, are somewhat troubled by this. In the sense that God has somebody with them while they're working. I was there when God established the heavens and marked out the horizon on the deep sea. When God thickened the clouds above and secured the fountains of the deep. This part sounds like Job. I was beside God as a master of crafts. I was having fun, smiling, frolicking, and delighting in the human race. This is one of the few passages in Scripture where we hear a sense of joy coming from God and those who are in God's presence. God's creative power and God's wisdom is personified with joy and with laughter and with play. Over the past several months and really several years, Kate has been spending a lot of time reading and thinking about this topic. And actually, some of her thinking about this topic led to this series, this On Purpose series. And we can't help but notice in our conversations back and forth that play is exactly the thing that adults lose as they grow up. This is the thing that we stop doing. We stop singing. We stop dancing. We stop making art. We stop playing games. Because we've decided that it's just not fitting for adults to do those things. Now, we might use the idea of play to sell things. It's Father's Day. You'll see ads with fathers playing with their kids, right? I noticed an ad kind of like that as I was walking into ShopRite yesterday. And maybe if we're lucky, you know, when our kids are young, we have kind of a renaissance of play. Because we feel like we can and we should play with our kids. And so there is a time when it seems very acceptable to play again, which is a great time. But your kids stop playing and you stop playing. And we're back to the thing that drives us more than anything else, work. We perceive that purpose and conversations about purpose are serious conversations for serious people. But today I want to argue for something different through this particular passage of Scripture. Imagine just for a moment God's uninhibited creative self at work to give us creatures such as the giraffe. Why would I create this creature that doesn't need a ladder to reach the tops of the trees, that's all neck and legs? A kangaroo. What's with a kangaroo? This thing that hops around and carries its babies in its pouch. A platypus? Are you kidding me? Really? It lays eggs, has a beak. I don't understand anything about that. Or how about a sloth? Because, you know, somehow, some way, we need to demonstrate to the world that speed is not everything. What's wrong with doing something that's fun, that's maybe pointless, just because we enjoy doing it? God doesn't seem to have a problem with it. I could argue that music has no kind of inherent purpose. It's not, strictly speaking, necessary for the furtherance of the human race. It's not, strictly speaking, necessary for worship. In fact, at the beginning of the Protestant Reformation, the most radical reformers went into churches and tore the organs out, pulled them down, wanted to go back to a church where what you did was chant the Psalms. That's what they wanted. Because an organ, sorry Bruce, is frivolity. And I would be willing to bet that you don't see music that way, though. I would actually be willing to bet that for every single one of you, there is a song that if I played it, you would have a wave of nostalgia that would bring tears to your eyes. At least one, and maybe more. God's purpose for us is so much bigger than that which achieves an end or accomplishes some great thing in the world. Often our purpose is not found in our work, but instead it's found in that thing which gives us joy. Just because it does. Not because we're the greatest at it. Not because anyone would necessarily hear or pay to hear me play the guitar or sing something or buy a picture that I've painted or hire me to build something for them. But instead, because when we let go and we learn to play, that somehow we're becoming the truest versions of ourselves. That we really can live into the idea that we are beings that are created for connection with God and with one another. So this week, I want to encourage you to think about something. What is it that you do just because it gives you joy? And have you given that thing in your life the time and attention that it deserves? Because purpose is much bigger than that which achieves an end or accomplishes something great. Instead, purpose is about, in large part, finding those things in our lives that bring us joy just because. Amen.
Works best when you're
We're going to take some time now to go to God in prayer, and as we do that, I invite you to think about that which brings you joy today, offered up to God as a celebration. If there are people that you're praying for, and if you're online with us today, if you want to share a prayer request, we encourage you to pray using first names only, please, on Facebook in the chat. So let's go to God in prayer together. Most holy God, for the joys and for the blessings of this day, we give you thanks. What are some of the things that bring you joy today? God, we give you thanks for the beauty of the season. We give you thanks for this day on which we celebrate those who have been our fathers and those who have been like fathers to us. God, we are grateful for those in our lives who have imparted their wisdom and who have stood by us and encouraged us, who have helped us along the way. God, we know that this day can be complicated too. We know that those who are missing their fathers today, because they've gone on to be with you, we know that those relationships sometimes are strained. But Lord, we pray that this day might be one where we recognize together and give thanks for the ways in which the men in our lives have shown up and encouraged us in a lot of different ways. God, as we are gathered here today, we give you thanks for the gift of music. We celebrate it. We thank you for the way that it transports us, that it moves us beyond ourselves. We give you thanks for all of the ways that you have shown us how to celebrate that creative side of all that you've given us, that blesses the world with something new, that blesses us with the ability to, again, move beyond ourselves into something that is peaceful, that is joyous, and that we can give thanks for. God, as we enter into this week, we know that there are people around the world who are hurting, that there are people that we care about who are hurting. So who are some of those that you're carrying with you this morning? As we are gathered here, we know that you hear our prayers for our families, for our church, for ourselves, for the world that we live in. As a nation, we come to this day when we celebrate Juneteenth. We celebrate freedom. And we remember. We remember all of the trials that those who helped to build this nation went through. And we think, too, about the inequality that persists. And we ask that you might renew our sense of justice, that we might work for a day when all people might enjoy equal opportunity and equal sharing in the blessing that you've given us. God, we pray that we might take part in that struggle. We pray that this moment, this Juneteenth, might be a day for us to be called back to it. God, we also lift up our voices for those around the world who live in places where there is no peace today. We pray and continue to pray for those being held captive. We pray for the people of Gaza. We pray for the coming of peace and ask that you might be at work in the hearts and minds of leaders, that they might recognize the need to seek peace and pursue it. God, we pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for all those who are missing loved ones in Ukraine and Russia. God, we pray for peace in that part of the world as well, and in so many other places where there is violence today. God, as we are gathered here, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you that you hear our prayers. And we pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we come to our time of stewardship this morning, just a word of thanks. As your monetary offerings and donations each week help, you know, support our music program as part of the overall budget. And our music program is one that is well known in the community and the surrounding areas for what we've done over so many years. And the staff all get a lot of joy out of doing this. Carol, Barb, Nate Gonzalez, who leads up our band, and myself have gotten a lot of joy out of doing this over the years. I've had the chance to have a professional career that pays the bills and a fun career that gives me a lot of joy on Sunday mornings, playing the frivolous organ, Joe. But it's great. But the only reason it's fun is because we have people that receive the message, and you send a lot of joy back to us. And we have a dedicated group of musicians in this church that make this happen and send the music out to you. So we have bell ringers from children to adults. We have our vocal musicians. We have our contemporary band members. And it's really amazing, you know, the number and the dedication. We were talking to choir the other night, how dedicated and reliable the people are coming out to choir each week. And that's really what makes it happen. So thank you. Your donations to the Medford United Methodist Church make our music ministry possible. Thank you, ringers and instrumentalists and all those folks out there that make it happen. And we're glad to do this every week. And we'll be back in full force in September. This piece is very challenging that Barb has put in front of the bell choir today. So I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving. God of all goodness, God of all joy, we thank you for all the moments that make life beautiful and good. We are grateful that generous giving creates those moments in our hearts. And so today, we pray that you might use the fruits of our joyful giving to help someone else. Amen.
Can we thank our music ministry one more time? And as you go forth from this place, go forth with joy in your hearts. Go forth knowing that your purpose is not solely to work, but go forth to play, to know that God has given you joy and that that is the great blessing that God has sent into our hearts. Go forth, the power, the grace, the love of God. Thank you.